Right. Well, for those of you who are new this evening, welcome once more. We've been working through something that we'll be calling Espresso Alpha. And the Alpha course, as I'm sure many people know, is an opportunity to explore the meaning of life, to ask different questions, especially about Christianity. And last week, John talked about who is Jesus. Is that right?
Yeah,
and so we're on sort of episode 2, week 2, which is looking at why did Jesus die. And whether you're a Christian here tonight or whether you wouldn't consider yourself a Christian, every time I go through this, even as a Christian, I learn something new. So I hope wherever you are on that spectrum that you'll get something out of this tonight. So why did Jesus die? And what I'm going to do is I'll talk a bit, and there's going to be a few slides coming up on here as well. And I actually got another little video on it. A few people ask this question, this is what they say.
I don't know. My understanding is that he died as a sacrifice for us that we can all live. But whether that's true or not, I don't know. We still have been told that he came down like to perform to save us from sin and stuff.
Who we are. And actually the cross is like the logo of Christianity. It captures the essence of what Christianity is. It's at the heart of what Christianity is. At the heart of Christianity, it's about the crucifixion, the cross, and the death of Jesus Christ. And it's interesting that a third of the Gospels are all about Jesus' death and the run-up to his death. And a good two-thirds of the New Testament is talking about and explaining the death of Christ. So it is a big thing. It's a very big thing. Holy Communion. You get all these different denominations in Christianity, but one of the main things that they all agree on is this celebrating the broken body of Jesus and the blood of Jesus on the cross through Holy Communion. So it is absolutely central. But why is it so important? And I want to talk about why this is so important tonight. It's interesting, I think, that many other leaders that we know, you know, Gandhi or Mother Teresa, it's their life that you think about. You know, what an amazing life they lived. And yes, Jesus did live an amazing life and had amazing teaching. But fundamentally, it's his death that Christians keep going on about. And why do they keep going on about it? Well, for Christians, the cross is important because it solves a problem. And it solves a problem that is pretty unfashionable sort of problem to talk about nowadays. A lot of people feel a bit embarrassed to talk about it. They don't want to talk about it. They feel it's old hat. But it helps to solve the problem of sin. And I've always liked to understand sin as a small word with I in the middle, because it's about me. Sin is about me doing things my way. It's about doing things on my terms. It's about being totally self-sufficient and just living life in the way I want it. It's about me. And Jesus died for our sins. We'll come back to that. But I'm sure often we think, well, wait a moment, I'm not an axe murderer. You know, I've not done major stuff wrong. Okay, sin, but yeah, I've not murdered anyone, I've not killed anyone. I hope you will say that. You will say that. Good, good. it's not that bad. I'm not that bad a person. And that's true, you're not that bad apart from him. No, we're joking. We're not that bad. And our core, in fact, is something very good. We're made in the image of God. We have the divine imprint on us. There is something at the core of who we are that is really special because we're made in the image of God. And we can do amazing things, creative things, wonderful things. But certainly if I'm being honest, and I think if we're all being honest, on the flip side of the coin, there's a load of stuff we've thought, we've said, we've done, which we just know hasn't been right. You know, the example that I'm still trying to get over all these years later was when I was eight, and I persuaded my friend Saul, good biblical name, didn't realise it at the time, but anyway, I jumped up onto these garages that overlooked a garden. I was living in Germany at the time, and they overlooked the gardens of these really rich people's houses. And in the back garden of all of them were swimming pools. And something in me thought, destroy. So I was only about eight. I said to Saul, can you pass me an apple? So Saul passes me an apple, like good accomplice. And I lob an apple into one of these pools. And the guy is mowing his lawn, so he can't hear anything, but the apple's there. I think, oh, he didn't see it. Oh, can you pass me another one? So he passed me another one. So I throw that in. I say, Saul, can you pass me a much bigger stone? So he's like, Saul, can I get this huge stone? I lob this huge stone in. And he still carries on just mowing his lawn, thinking, right, breeze block. So Saul kind of pushes this huge breeze block. And I lob this breeze block off, I'm standing on these garages overlooking the garden, into the pool, massive splash. And you see this guy just suddenly stop and go, just, you know, some water. He looks in his pool, you can see his apples popping, and his breeze block sinking. And he looks up, he sees me, and he goes, do, which means you. And I leg it as fast as I can. He runs after me, and he catches me, and it was just the most frightening thing ever. And he took me to my dad, and my dad said, yeah, I'm going to punish him. And My dad didn't realise that the word he used in German for punish, because my dad's German wasn't perfect, is I'm going to kill him. No, stop going to kill him. Getting back to the point, I knew. I didn't have to be taught that that was wrong. There was something in me. I knew what I was doing was just wrong. And I think if we're being honest, no one's had to teach us how to feel guilty. It's just we know that there's stuff in our lives that isn't right. Someone once said to me, just so you make sure, Marcus, you realise that your life isn't totally right. Imagine when you die and you go to heaven and St. Peter's there. By the way, this bit's not in the Bible, this is me just telling a story. St. Peter's there at the pearly gates and he says, before you go in, you've got to watch in the cinema a film of your life. Everything you've ever thought, said or done, and we'll see how you get on. Now, I think most of us would feel a bit uneasy by that because it includes what we thought, it includes what we said. Anyway, I said to my friend, that's fine, I reckon I can do that. So I sat there and, you've got eternity to watch this film, so it doesn't matter, you can take your time. He said, okay, now everybody else comes into the cinema who has ever featured in your life, in your thought life, in anyone you've ever come into contact with, and they're now going to watch that film as well. At that point, I was like, okay, I'm guilty. Fair enough. I fess up, you know, the stuff I've done wrong. And I think if we're all being honest, we know. And the Bible puts it like this. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Now, you know, I'm sure there's some very good people in here far better than me. But fundamentally, compared to the perfect God, all of us have fallen short. And that's called different things, but one of the things it's called is sin. So you might be sitting there going, okay, fair enough, I might have done stuff wrong. But so what? So what? Why do you have to keep going on about it? You know, why do we keep having to make such a big deal about it? And the reason is because it has consequences. The sin we do in life has consequences. It has knock-on effect. And I want to quickly just go through some consequences. They all begin with P, because when you're at Vicar Factory, they teach you to make everything start with the same letter. So the first one is pollutes. The thing about sin, and I found it in my own life, is when I've done stuff wrong, I feel dirty inside. And you go, you try and deny it, no, I don't feel dirty inside, I feel fine. But actually, you do. And there was a guy I had to pray this on last week. It is a privilege of my job. But he'd been up to some pretty rough stuff. I won't get into the details because that's totally confidential. But one of the things he said was, I just feel dirty inside. And that's because sin pollutes us. It kind of makes us feel dirty inside. So that's one of the things it does. The second P is, I'll go through that, is power. The problem with sin is it's addictive. There's something about it which is nice. That's something about temptation and doing something, which is nice, but then it kind of hooks you in. And over the years, I've worked with people who've clearly been under the power of sin, because I've worked with addicts, and if anyone here has worked in the world of addiction, you can see how addictive doing this stuff is. And here, in this room, I don't know whether there's people here who have struggled with alcohol or drugs or whatever. Maybe, maybe not. But I'm sure there's people here who have found themselves, you know, gossiping when they know they should, or envying, or, they can't stop watching porn on the computer or something. You know, it could be anything. Or they can't stop feeling resentful about things. And that's the thing about sin. It has a power. And it starts to control us. The Bible talks about us becoming a slave to sin. So that's the second P. What was the first one? Police. Second one, power. The third one is it creates a partition. And I'm sure you find this in your own life. If you've had an argument with someone, with a friend or with someone you know, it feels like often, especially if you've done something, it feels like there's a wall between you. It feels like you're not clearly communicating with them because there's this kind of partition between you, because there's something wrong between you. And the problem when we sin is it puts up a wall between us and God. It creates this partition between us. And we're made to have a perfect relationship with a perfect God. And the problem is, if we've got sin that we haven't dealt with, there's this barrier between us and God. I often hear non-Christians or people who don't know God, they say, I find, you know, I don't hear anything from God. I don't know anything of God. And I think, well, actually, part of that, if you haven't had your sin dealt with, there's a barrier between you and God. The perfect God and the imperfect us. We need to, you know, we need to get back into that place of relationship. So unless that's dealt with, there's partition. First one is? Second one is? Third one is partition. The final one is as a penalty. And I really feel this. And I don't know whether you guys do. When people do stuff wrong, take the credit crunch, take the bankers, there's part, take George Osborne, George, no, scrub that bit, George Osborne. But there's, when stuff's done wrong, when people need, like, someone needs to pay for this. Take abuse at the little Ted nursery that happened. You know, there's part of you that thinks, someone's got to pay the price for this. You know, take Manu Tuilagi hitting Chris Ashton on the rugby pitch so that Northampton didn't win the final. You know, there was part of me thinking, justice needs to be done. And I think the reason we feel like, you know what, that someone needs to pay for this is because there's something of God in us. Because that's how God feels about us. He's like, something needs to be done. You know, we don't live in a neutral universe. We've got to do something about what's gone wrong. There's a penalty to sin as well. So that's the bad news. That's the bad news. So can we all just breathe out? Okay, right. So that's kind of the consequences of sin. The good news is this. The good news is that Jesus dying on the cross came to sort out the sin problem. Right? He came to sort out the sin problem. And this is perhaps the most famous verse in the New Testament or the Bible. It's this, for God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. You see, God so loved the world. That's the key. He loved us so much that he's like, I need to sort out this mess. And he sent Jesus to die for you and me, to pay that penalty, to set us free. Why? Because he loves us. And it's what theologians call the self-substitution of God. The self-substitution of God. He does something for us that we just can't do for ourselves. He comes to sort out the sin problem. So these are the kind of images that are used, because if you're anything like me, I think, okay, that's cool. I like the fact that Jesus comes, but how does dying on a cross all work? I want to know how the cross, you know, how does that work then? And the Bible has different images to help us understand how Jesus dying on a cross sorts out the sin problem. And it uses different images. And the first one that it uses is what's called the temple image. And if you go back 2,000 years ago, the Jewish people, as I'm sure you know, or some of you will know, one of the things they did to get rid of their feeling of pollution in their life, a feeling of sin in their life, is that they would confess their sins over a perfect animal, like a perfect lamb or something like that. And they would confess the sins and then they would slaughter the animal. And the blood of the animal would run. And it would be a sense that that pollution has been put onto the animal and taken away from them. And I know it sounds a bit odd to us, but that's what they did. But there was always a sense that that wouldn't quite do it. There was something about that that wouldn't quite do it. And Jesus said this. He said, actually, no, it wasn't Jesus. It was John the Baptist who said of Jesus, he said, look, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Jesus is saying, I'm the perfect sacrifice. You were doing that with those lambs in the temple, and it, you know, it kind of felt like it was helping, but I am the perfect sacrifice. And that's one of the images that the Bible uses to explain what happened on the cross. But there's no one image that is perfect, so let me show you a couple of others. The next one is the slave market. I talked about one of the problems of sin is the power it has on us. And what would happen a couple of thousand years ago is people who are in debt, and I don't know if anyone here has ever been in debt, or whether you're in debt. which is great, but it has a power over you. And what would happen is if you got into debt, one of the things you could do is you'd go down to the slave market and you would put something around your neck saying how much you're in debt, like 5,000 denarii, or whatever it was. And that was called your ransom price. And what people could do is they could say, okay, I will pay your debt. I will pay that 5,000 to the person who you owe it to. So you're let off of the debt, you're free of debt, but now you're my slave, you come and work for me. And that was called the ransom price. And Jesus says, I've come to give my life as a ransom. So Jesus is saying, I pay that, but you know what? You're not my slave. I'm going to pay it and I'm going to set you free. So that's another way of thinking about the cross and what Jesus has done. A third way is by thinking that Jesus brings us back into the family. He brings us back into relationship with God. I talked about that partition, that wall between us and God because there's something wrong in our lives. And it's a bit like this. Someone, I remember years ago, explained it to me like this. They said, let's say this is us, and this is Jesus, and we've got this sin stuff, which is stopping us from having a relationship with God, because there's something big and chunky, this is a really boring textbook by the way, in the way. And Jesus on the cross, he takes that stuff, that sin, and what that allows us to do is to restore us back into relationship with God, because there's nothing in the way anymore. And some of you will know that on the cross, Jesus said the words, my God, why have you forsaken me? Because for the first time in his life ever, he felt our rubbish that got in the way of his relationship with God. He felt that, and he took it on the cross. And so he takes it, and it means we're free to be back in relationship with God. We don't have to go and come to God saying, I'm dirty, I'm full of rubbish, because Jesus has taken it. We can have a really clean and open and perfect relationship with God because of that. The final image that's used is that of the law court. And this deals with the penalty. You know when I said, somebody has to pay for what's gone wrong? You know, there's just something in us which is like, somebody's going to pay for this. Justice needs to be done. And this little video here just is one way of thinking about it.
There once were two little boys who were best friends. They played together, went to school together, they even went to university together. They were inseparable. Until their careers took them in very different directions. One became a lawyer, the other a criminal. As one was promoted to a judge, the other disappeared deeper and deeper into a life of crime. Eventually, the criminal was caught and sent to trial. On the fateful day in the courtroom, he came face to face with his old best friend, the judge. And so, the judge had a dilemma. He loved his friend, but he had to do justice. And so, he had to find him the appropriate penalty for the offence. It was a huge fine. There was no way he could ever afford to pay what he owed. But then, the judge took off his robes, went down, stood with his friend, and wrote out a cheque covering the cost. He paid the penalty himself.
So, Jesus died to pay that penalty for us. He died for my sin, he died for your sin, and he took the penalty that you and I could never pay ourselves, similar to what the little video showed. And he did it to make us free. He did it because he loves us, to make us free, to set us free from the sin. The thing is, and this is where the challenge is this evening, a response is required. So this has been done, but a response is required. Jesus is offering to make that payment for us. He's done it. He's saying, this is it. And it's a bit like talked about the check. I wrote out a check earlier, and this check is for the amount of all debts paid. Okay? So all your debts are paid, all your sins paid for. It's been signed by Jesus. Nice signature. Today's date, because the offer is for today. The offer is for now. It's for this evening. This is real. And it's made payable to you. ? And it's you ? Because the thing about Jesus and the thing about Christianity is God never forces us. He always gives us a choice. It says God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. And the words I just want to highlight right now, whoever believes, a choice is required. A response is required. Whether we say yes, thank you very much, I'll take the check, I want my debts forgiven, thank you very much. Or whether we say, you know what, no thank you, and we rip it up. The choice is yours tonight. So what I'd love to do is, just for the dignity of anyone here who's thinking, you know what, I would actually like that. I would like my rubbish taken away from me. I'd like to just provide an opportunity to pray for that. And if we could just all just give that person, whoever it is, just quickly to you, let's just bow our heads, shut our eyes. I'm going to say a very simple prayer. It might be also that tonight you're thinking, you know what, I am a Christian, but I've sort of deviated, I've gone off, I've gone back to some old ways, and tonight is a good night, given what I've just heard, actually, to say yes again, and to receive that love and that forgiveness. So, wherever you are, whatever situation you're in, if you'd like to, I'm just going to pray a simple prayer, and just so you know, I think it's always good to tell people what I'm going to pray before I pray. So it's going to basically be a prayer that says, sorry for the wrong stuff. Thank you for dealing with, for loving me and dealing with that stuff on the cross. And please fill me so that I can live a life with you moving forward. So just say this in your heart if you want to be set free from the problem of sin and accept Jesus once again. Father God, I am sorry for stuff that I've done, thought and said, the stuff that has polluted me, the stuff that has created a partition between me and you, the stuff that's had power over me. I want to say sorry for that tonight and just be honest about it to you. I thank you that you love me so much that you came and you died on a cross to save me so that I can live a life with you. Please come into my life and please fill me up in a whole new way so that I can live a life walking with you, filled with you, living for you, so I can live my life again in a whole new way in relationship with you. Amen. Right. Well, that's the talk. There's now an opportunity just in your groups to chat. There's people on your table who will just sort of, you know, open up the conversation. If you have prayed that prayer, do tell someone, because it's good to tell someone, because then that makes it real. You know, you're like, actually I did, and it's good to be back. So we'll pull some background music. We've got about 15-20 minutes. We'll chat a bit, and then we'll go down the pub.